Hello, friends, and welcome to this week's Digital Discipleship. My name is Marvin. I'm one of the pastors at Christian Assembly, and it's a pleasure to be with you. So for the next 15 minutes or so, I invite you to read a portion of God's Word with me. So pull up a chair, grab your favorite beverage, have your scripture ready, because we're going to look at a portion of God's scripture. I don't know if it's just me, or if you feel the same way as me, but have you felt like this election cycle has gone on forever? I mean, years. I feel like it's just been a never-ending political cycle that we happen to be in. And I find myself a little exhausted by it, to be honest with you. But one of the things that I find interesting is how often I'll hear politicians say things like, you know, if I get elected, I'm going to bring this nation back together. I'm the person that can bring true unity to a divided nation. Now, we know for sure that our nation is pretty divided. And while I hope that people that make those kinds of statements are well-intended and have good intentions, the reason that I, like maybe you, kind of roll my eyes a little bit is because we know how difficult that is to accomplish, and we know what a large task that is. And so we almost find it a little sarcastic when we hear those comments. But what do our elected officials have to do to bring a divided nation back together again? How can we achieve true unity? And more importantly, I think the question that maybe you and I should be asking is, what can we do? What can you and I do to bring a divided nation back together? How can we gain some sense of unity, which I'm guessing we all want, back to this nation? Well, we're going to actually look at a story in scripture, in biblical history, that, believe it or not, had a very fractured and divided nation of Israel. And we're going to see how their new ruler, King David, came into power and what he did to try to restore unity to a very fractured nation. Before we jump into that, would you pray with me? Father, we pray, Lord, for the United States of America. We pray that you would restore unity to what we know is a great nation. More importantly, we pray that you would use us, Lord, your people, to achieve that unity, Lord, that we would be agents of peace, not division, that we would bring love and kindness and gentleness to every interaction that we have. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, in the book of 2 Samuel, the king of Israel, King Saul, has just died. And what ensues after his death is a very, very bloody and very messy transition of power. His son and his military commander had wanted to stay in power, so some of the tribes of Israel kind of followed them. David, who you might remember, had been anointed years ago, even while Saul was alive, to be the future king of Israel. Judah named him as their king. And so you had some tribes that were following these other guys. You had a tribe that was following David, and in between there was bloodshed and messiness, and to say the least, it was a very divided people of Israel at that time. Finally, David was able to strike a deal and bring all of the tribes together, and they anointed him as king. And you might think, what is the first thing that David would do as the new ruler of the newly formed, of the newly brought back together tribes of Israel? Because you see, whatever he did first would set the tone for the rest of his reign. Whatever he did first would really impact how divided and fractured, or how unified, the people of Israel would be. So we'll pick up the story in chapter 6 and in verse 1. It says, David again brought together all the able-bodied men of Israel, 30,000 of them. And he and all his men went to Baalah in Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherubim on the Ark. You see, in the times of the Old Testament, this Ark of the Covenant was the presence of God amongst the people of Israel. It literally was God's presence. Now, you and I now have access to the Holy Spirit. But before the Holy Spirit was gifted to us in the Old Testament, the people relied on this ark for his presence. This ark also signified a place where they could go and offer worship before the Lord. So this was an important, it was not just a piece of furniture. This was the literal representation of God's presence amongst the people. So it was extremely important. And David understood the importance of God's presence bringing unity back to a fractured people. The king before him, Saul, had not made any efforts to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to its rightful place. And as we know, his reign is marked by failure and largely known as unsuccessful. And David understood that if his reign was going to be different from Saul's, it would be marked by a proper place of worship, by desperately seeking God's presence in their lives. Now here's the thing. If we as Americans ever want to see our nation regain its unity, it's not really going to be some new policy that's going to do it. It's going to be when you and I, the people of God, get desperate about chasing after his presence in our lives first. When we fall on our knees, when we seek after God, when we invite his Holy Spirit, his presence in our lives to fill us, our homes, our neighborhoods, our cities, and by extension, our nation. And I'm not going to sit around and wait until November 3rd for someone to invite me to seek after God's presence. I'm doing it now. I'm going to pray for those in power. I'm going to pray for those who are going to come into power. And I'm going to do it with all the love and gentleness and forgiveness and kindness in the world that His Holy Spirit invites me to. I'm going to invite His presence in my life so that His fruit will be the outpouring of me seeking His presence. So this did it, right? David went out and got the ark. He gathered his best men. He built a new cart so that they can transport the ark. So this brought the nation of Israel back together, right? Well, not exactly. You see, this is where the story gets even more interesting. David did gather his best men. He did build a new ark so they could transport he did build a new cart so they could transport the ark efficiently. And then it happened. While they were transporting the ark, one of the oxen stumbled, and one of the guys went over to reach to help it along, and immediately that man was struck down by God, and he died in that place. You see, David was unsuccessful in his attempt to bring back the ark. And he was furious. He was really angry because he didn't understand why he had failed. So he just kind of abandoned the mission and let the ark sit there at somebody's house for several months. But why did David fail? Well, he failed because even though he had good intentions and he was passionate about what he was doing, he didn't follow God's instruction as to how this ark should have been transported. See, the Bible the Old Testament scriptures were clear in the book of Numbers that ark should have been transported on the shoulders of the priest, the Levite tribe. And David didn't follow those instructions. He simply just built a cart and set it along. And even though he had good intentions and he was passionate, he wasn't grounded in God's scripture. So here's where I want to caution us. It's not enough that you and I could have good intentions and even heartfelt passion. I mean, lots of people are passionate about lots of things. You see, but when our passion, our heartfelt passion, is then grounded in God's truth and in His Word, that's when we're going to achieve true unity. Jesus Himself says that we've got to be worshipers who both worship in spirit and in truth. So we've got to be passionate about seeking God's presence in our lives, but we've got to allow that passion. We've got to make sure that that passion is grounded in His Word, in His Scripture. So to truly invite God's unifying presence in our nation, we must be passionate about His presence, but let that passion be grounded in a truth, in true biblical understanding. So let's be people who are both passionate about His presence, about inviting His Spirit to reign and rule over our lives, but let's make sure that that passion is grounded in true biblical understanding. David was persistent, though. We got to give him that. And so several months later, he tried again. And this time, he did it the right way. He had the priest carry the ark, and every six paces, they would stop and offer sacrifices. And eventually, the ark was restored to Jerusalem. The people once again had a rightful place of worship. David was able to dance in the streets and was able to be completely authentic and transparent before all the people in his ability to worship. David would go on to reign 33 more years after this event, and mostly is known as the greatest king that Israel has ever seen. So friends, let me invite us in this moment as we're studying God's word together. Let's be agents of unity, you and I, believers in Jesus Christ, those of us who call ourselves Christians. Let's be agents in unity, and let's be those who passionately seek after God's presence in our lives, but do so with an understanding of who He is, with an understanding of His Word. See, when we invite God's Spirit into our lives, when we do this, His fruit will be the outpouring of His presence. Galatians says that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, can you imagine with me a nation that is guided by those values? If the fruit of the Spirit were the guiding principles in this nation, that is how we could achieve true unity in our nation. Would you pray with me? Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray for the unity of our nation. We pray for the elections happening on November 3rd. But Father, would you help us, your people, be people who chase desperately after your Spirit in our lives so that your fruit would be the outpouring of that, and that we would be guided by love, by joy, by peace, by forbearance, by kindness, by goodness, by faithfulness, by gentleness, and by self-control. And these would become the values by which all of our interactions are colored, Lord. Let it start with me, Lord. Let it start in my house. Let it start with your people. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, everyone. Have a great week.